Welcome to Pharmacy Prep. Today I like to present an exciting new format of drug monograph presentation that is in the form of audio and video drug monograph. Here I like to present benzodiazepines pharmacology and clinical uses, and this presentation is in the format of audio and visual combined together, which is Pharmacast, that is a part of the Pharmacy Prep program. So in this Pharmacast video presentation, there will be a discussion about benzodiazepine pharmacology and clinical uses on the high yield points by the two experts. So let's start.
Okay, so today we're going to be talking about something pretty important, especially if you're, you know, dealing with healthcare in any way, mm-hmm. whether that's getting ready for some exams or you're actually like out there, you know, boots on the ground.
Yeah.
We're diving deep into benzodiazepines.
It's a big one.
It is a big one.
You're going to see it everywhere.
We're going to see it everywhere.
So this is really like, you know, the need to know.
Exactly. We're going to give you the what you need to know, cut through all that, you know.
Cut through the noise.
Yeah, all the noise and highlight the stuff that you really need.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So what we're going to do is we're going to go through like the actual drugs themselves, how they're broken down, what they're used for clinically, when you shouldn't use them, like, you know, big no-nos.
Red flags.
Yeah, red flags, precautions to take.
Right.
And then how they actually work in your body, like what's going on.
The mechanism.
Yeah, the mechanism of action, yeah. And then, of course, we got to talk about you know, things that can go wrong.
Right.
Adverse drug reactions, drug interactions.
Yeah.
You, what happens if you take too much? Yeah. Like the whole nine yards.
The whole nine yards, yeah. Okay.
Right. All right, so let's start with just the benzodiazepines themselves.
Okay.
You know, we have this list here.
We do.
And the first thing we need to get down are the names, right?
Yeah.
You're going to have the generic name, which is what you see in like the literature, scientific papers.
Right.
And then you're going to have brand names.
Right.
Which is what patients are going to be like, oh, I take.
I'm on.
Yeah, I'm on.
Right.
Yeah. So to start us off, we have alprazolam.
Alprazolam.
Okay, Xanax.
Xanax, okay.
That's a big one.
Yeah, that's a big one, yep.
Bromazepam, that's lectopam.
Lectopam.
Taurus epoxide.
Equilibrium.
Clobazam, and that's frisium.
Frisium.
Clonidam, which is Rivotril.
Rivotril.
And then we have clarazepam, which is marketed as Tranzine.
Tranzine. So that's like our first,
yeah.
The first little.
Yeah, that's a handful.
Handful there.
To get us started.
All right.
Then we have diazepam, that's a big one, you know.
Oh, yeah.
That's Valium.
Valium, yep.
We've got flurazepam, that's Delmane.
Delmane.
Lorazepam, which is Ativan. Bit of the lamb, or Verst.
Versta.
Nitrazepam.
Nitrazepam.
Mogadon.
Mogadon.
Oxazepam. Cerax.
Tenazepam.
Tenazepam, which is Restoril.
Restoril.
And then we have triazolam, that's Halcyon.
Halcyon, okay. So that's a mouthful?
A mouthful.
So it is.
A mouthful of the benzodiazepines.
But it's good to know both the generic and the brand names.
It is, yes.
So that you're not, you know.
Lost.
Yeah, confused.
When you see one or the other.
Exactly.
Exactly.
Okay. Yeah. All right, so now that we've got the names down, we can get into how they're broken down.
Yeah, categorized.
Categorized, yeah.
Right.
So based on how long they work.
Duration of action.
Duration of action.
Yeah. So we have our sources categorize them into short, intermediate, and long acting.
Okay.
So the short-acting ones, those are like triazolam,
mm-hmm.
midazolam.
Okay.
So these are the ones where they kick in pretty quick.
Right.
And then they leave your system pretty quick.
Okay. Okay.
So you're not going to have that like lingering effect.
Right.
So it's good for like if you need someone to just chill out for a little bit.
Right.
Like before procedure or something like that.
Yeah, okay.
Or like, you know, they're having trouble falling asleep, but you don't want them to be groggy in the morning.
Right, right.
So those are your short-acting guys.
Okay.
Then we get into the intermediate-acting.
Okay, so like in between.
Yeah, in between.
The short and the long.
Exactly, yeah. So that's like your alprazolam,
mm-hmm.
lorazepam,
okay.
oxazepam, and temazepam.
Okay.
So those are, you know, they last a bit longer than the short-acting ones, but they're not going to like knock you out for a whole day.
Right.
So it's good for like, you know, anxiety disorders or if they're having trouble staying asleep.
Okay.
You know, that kind of thing.
Gotcha, gotcha.
And then lastly, we have the long-acting.
Long-acting ones.
Yeah. So these are the ones that hang out in your system for
like
a while.
A while.
And so that's like didazepam.
Okay.
Chlorazepam, Flurazepam,
cool.
Clonazepam,
okay.
Clorazepam, and Natrazepam.
Okay.
So because they have a longer half-life, they stick around.
They stick around, yeah.
They're good for, like, you know, sustained relief from anxiety.
Okay.
Or for controlling seizures.
Right.
But you got to be careful because they can build up in your system.
Oh, okay.
You know, and then you can have more side effects.
Right.
And it takes longer for them to get out of your system, too.
So that's, yeah, if you're weaning somebody off, it's...
Yeah, it's going to take a while.
Yeah, that makes sense.
So, yeah, that's basically how they're broken down.
So we have our short, our intermediate, and our long-acting.
Exactly. And that kind of gives you a framework for, like, you know...
Yeah, yeah.
When you would use one over the other.
Absolutely. That's super helpful. Okay, so let's talk about the specific clinical uses.
Yeah, we'll get into it.
Okay, so for anxiety and panic disorders, we see alprazolam.
Oh.
That's usually an oral tablet, diazepam.
Yeah.
Which comes in like all sorts of...
It comes in everything.
It comes in everything. Oral solution.
Oh, yeah.
Rectal.
A rectal injection.
Like, injection. Wow. Okay.
Yeah. If you need to, like, get it in there quick.
Right. Right.
We got lorazepam.
Lorazepam.
That could be oral sublingual.
Sublingual.
Which is, you know, under the tongue, it absorbs faster that way.
Faster. Yeah.
And then injection. And then oxazepam as an oral tablet.
Oxazepam. Okay.
So... Yeah, it's nice because you have all those different options
right
for how to get it into the patient.
Right.
Depending on, you know, what the situation is.
Right, right. Absolutely. That makes sense. Okay. And then what about insomnia?
Insomnia. Okay. So for that, we have flurazepam. That's an oral capsule.
Okay.
And atrazepam. That's an oral tablet. Temazepam is a capsule.
Mm-hmm.
And then triazolam is also a tablet.
Oh.
So you'll notice that they're using like those shorter acting ones.
Right, right.
Because you want them to fall asleep.
Right.
But you don't want them to be like... you know, sleeping all day.
Right, right.
So you need something that's going to, like, you know, do its job and then get out.
Get out, exactly. Okay. Yeah. All right. And then for seizures, what do we got?
Seizures, okay. So we got clonazepam as an oral tablet.
Okay.
Clobazam,
oh.
Also oral, and then diazepam again.
Oh, diazepam.
Yeah, so that can be oral, rectal, or IV.
Okay.
So that's really helpful. If you need to stop a seizure quickly.
You need to get it in there.
Yeah, you need to get it in there fast.
Right, right. Okay. And then for sedation?
Sedation, okay.
Pre-op or?
Yeah, pre-op, ICU.
Yeah.
So you're going to see midazolam, and that's usually given by injection because, again, you want that quick onset.
You need it to happen.
You need it to happen now.
Right, right.
And then lorazepam, which, you know, we talked about, that one can be oral, sublingual, or injection.
Okay.
So again, option.
Option.
Yeah.
Okay,
so those are the big ones, but then there's a couple more.
Okay.
Diazepam, it's good for muscle spasticity.
Oh, okay.
So that comes in oral solution and injection as well.
Okay.
And then lastly, for alcohol withdrawal, you've got chlordiazepoxide as an oral capsule.
Yeah.
Diazepam, that can be oral or IV.
Okay.
Especially for those really like intense withdrawal symptoms.
Right, right.
And then oxazepam is an oral tablet.
Okay.
And that's actually preferred for people with liver issues.
Oh, okay.
Because it's metabolized differently.
Okay, I see. Gotcha.
Yeah.
Interesting.
So, you know, you can see that they're used for a lot of different things.
A lot of different things. Yeah, this is a really versatile class of drugs.
Yeah, it is.
Okay, so we have like what they're used for, right?
Right.
Now, how do they work?
Yeah, what's the mechanism?
Yeah, how do they do all this stuff?
It all boils down to the GABA.
GABA?
That's gamma-aminobutyric acid.
Okay.
And it's like the main inhibitory neurotransmitter in your brain.
So it's like the brain's brakes.
Exactly. It's the brakes. Yeah. It slows everything down.
Gotcha, gotcha.
And benzodiazepines, what they do is they make those brakes work better.
Okay, so they're not like GABA themselves.
Right, they're not GABA.
But they're making the GABA.
They're like boosting it.
Boosting it, okay.
Yeah.
So how do they do that?
All right, so on your neurons, you have these things called GABA-A receptors.
Okay.
And the benzodiazepines, they bind to a specific spot on that receptor.
Mm-hmm.
Now, they don't actually activate the receptor themselves.
They don't.
No, they just change its shape a little bit.
Okay.
And that makes it easier for GABA to bind.
So it's like a...
Making the parking spot bigger.
Okay.
So GABA can just like slide right in.
Okay, I see. So then what happens when GABA binds?
Okay, so when GABA binds to the GABA-A receptor,
mm-hmm.
it opens up a channel.
Okay.
And that channel, it lets these negatively charged chloride ions, Cl,
right, okay.
into the neuron.
Okay.
And when that happens, it changes the electrical charge inside the neuron.
Okay.
And it makes it harder for the neuron to fire.
Fire, okay.
Yeah, it's like it's too relaxed to fire.
I see.
That's called hyperpolarization.
Oh, hyperpolarization.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So the benzos are making the GABA work better, and that's causing this like hyperpolarization.
Exactly.
And that's what's leading to all of these effects.
Yeah. So basically you're calming down the brain.
Calming it down. Okay.
Yeah. So less anxiety.
Less anxiety.
More sedation. The muscles relax.
Right.
And seizures are less likely to happen.
Okay.
So it's all about calming things down.
Calming things down. All right.
Yeah.
Okay. That makes sense. It all kind of ties together.
It all comes together.
Yeah. It all comes together. Okay. So now.
Now for the not so fun stuff.
Yeah. Now that we've covered kind of the, you know.
The basics.
Yeah. The basics.
Good stuff.
The good stuff. The uses, how they work. Let's talk about when you absolutely should not use them.
Yeah. The contraindications.
Some contraindications.
Yeah. So first off, if someone's allergic to benzodiazepines.
Yeah, that's a no-brainer.
Yeah, obviously you don't want to give them that.
Obviously.
Another one is myasthenia gravis.
Myasthenia gravis.
Yeah, that's a muscle weakness disorder.
Okay.
And benzodiazepines can actually make that worse.
Oh, I see.
So that's a big no-no.
Okay.
Acute narrow-angle glaucoma.
Acute narrow-angle glaucoma.
Yeah, so benzos can increase the pressure in the eye.
Right, right.
And that's a big problem if you have glaucoma.
Right.
Pregnancy, especially if you're using it as a sleep aid.
Okay.
So that's a contraindication.
Contraindication. Yeah. Okay. So we really need to watch out for that.
Yeah. You got to be careful.
Okay.
And then severe respiratory insufficiency.
Respiratory insufficiency.
And, yeah. So if someone's having trouble breathing.
Right.
Benzodiazepines can actually make that worse too.
Because they depress the.
They depress your breathing.
Breathing. Okay.
So yeah, those are the big ones to watch out for.
Okay. So these are situations where you absolutely should not use.
No, not at all.
These medications.
No.
Okay. What about, you know, maybe not absolutely contraindicated.
Right.
But we need to be super cautious.
Yeah. You got to be careful.
Yeah. The warnings and precautions.
The warnings and precautions.
Okay.
Yeah. So the elderly.
The elderly.
They're more sensitive to benzodiazepines.
Okay.
So you got to use lower doses.
Right, right.
And really watch them closely.
Right, closely, yeah.
Same thing with people with liver problems.
Liver problems, okay.
Yeah, because they can't break down the drugs as well.
Oh.
And then it builds up in their system.
It builds up, okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, and then you mentioned this earlier, the respiratory problems.
Yeah, so even if it's not like super severe, still got to be careful.
Because it can still make it worse.
It can still make it worse.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. And then the big one, dependence.
Dependence, right?
And withdrawal.
And withdrawal.
Yeah. So the longer you take these drugs,
mm-hmm.
the more likely you are to become dependent on them.
Dependence.
Yeah. Both physically and mentally.
Yeah, mentally.
Yeah. And if you stop taking them suddenly, after taking them for a while,
right,
you can go through withdrawal.
Yeah, you get those nasty withdrawal symptoms.
Yeah, it's not pretty.
It's not pretty, no.
No.
And it can be dangerous, right?
It can be very dangerous, yeah.
Okay, so you really?
Yeah, taper them off slowly.
You gotta taper. You gotta taper.
All okay. Right.
What else? What else should we be cautious about?
You know, sometimes people have these paradoxical reactions.
Paradoxical.
Yeah, like the opposite of what you'd expect.
So instead of calming down?
Yeah, they get agitated.
They get agitated?
Anxious. Even aggressive.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah, it's weird, but it happens.
Yeah.
It is.
Okay, so watch out for that.
Definitely watch out for that.
Anything else we should be thinking about?
Yeah, if someone has depression.
Okay.
Especially if they're suicidal.
Oh, right.
You got to be really careful with benzodiazepines.
Because they can make it worse.
They can make it worse.
Okay.
And they might mask what's really going on.
Right. They're not addressing the root problem.
Exactly.
Okay. So lots of warnings, lots of precautions.
It's not something to take lightly.
Definitely not. It's a powerful class of drug.
It is.
You know, affects the brain.
Absolutely.
You got to be careful. So.
So yeah, you really got to know your patient.
Know the patient.
Their history. Their medications.
All of it.
Yeah, the whole picture.
The whole picture. Okay, so just to like kind of wrap everything up.
Okay.
We've talked about the names, how they're broken down, short, intermediate, long acting,
mm-hmm.
what they're used for.
Yeah.
The really important, like.
The big no-nos.
Yeah, the big no-nos.
The precautions.
The precautions. So.
Yeah, it's a lot.
It is. It is. But super important for anyone who's going to be dealing with these medications.
Absolutely.
You know, prescribing them, administering them, whatever it might be.
This is the foundation.
This is the foundation
yeah, yeah.
for understanding these drugs.
Mm-hmm.